everyone to our first humanities working group event of the semester. Pleased to have so many of you turn out this afternoon. I'm Mary Case, University Librarian here at UIC and a member of the Digital Humanities Working Group. And my colleagues on the group include Steve Jones from the Department of Communications and Ben Williams from the Graduate College, and sitting there in the back. And I do want to acknowledge Ben, who really was responsible for all the planning for this afternoon's event, and we really appreciate his efforts to bring us this wonderful presentation. And our thanks to the Humanities Center for hosting us. So let me introduce today's speaker, Professor Stephen Brier. As a professor in the Ph.D. program in urban education and a member of the program's language, culture, and context specialization, Stephen Brier teaches courses on the history of public education. His current work focuses on the struggles over community control of the New York City public schools in the 1960s and their impact on teacher unionism and educational reform. He also works on the history of the City University of New York. Brier founded the Interactive Technology and Pedagogy Certificate Program at the Graduate Center in 2002, and he continues to serve as its coordinator, teaches one of the program's core courses, and supervises all of its independent studies. He is a historian who has published widely on issues ranging from U.S. social and labor history to the uses of digital technologies and tools to improve academic teaching, learning, and research. He was a founding director of the Graduate Center's American Social History Project, Center for Media Learning, which he headed for 18 years, and was the executive producer of the project's award-winning Who Built America multimedia curriculum, including textbooks, videos, and CD-ROMs. He has co-produced other award-winning websites, including History Matters and the September 11th Digital Archive. Brier, who previously served for 11 years as a senior administrator at the Graduate Center, is also the Graduate Center's Senior Academic Technology Officer and the co-director of its new media lab, and also the father of our colleague, Jenny Brier. Today, Steve will present, with the important things, Steve will present Doing Digital Humanities in a Large Urban Public University.
Thank you. Let me start by stealing a line from John Reed when he addressed the workers' councils in the then brand new Soviet Union in 1917 after the revolution. He said, "I bring you greetings from the American working class." I'm going to say the same thing with just the coda, the added coda, the academic wing of it that works at the City University of New York. I'm seriously going to do a shout out to all of you who are active in the strike that you engaged in earlier this week, which was a beacon for academic labor movement across the country. And I want to say that we're very proud to be associated and affiliated with you. I do bring greetings from the leadership of the PSC CUNY, which is my faculty union that I'm a proud member of. So let's start by defining what digital humanities is and then ask what role should DH play in an urban public university like the University of Illinois Chicago. As the title of my colleague Matt Gold's recent hefty collection, Debates in the Digital Humanities, suggests, people who self-define as DHers have trouble even agreeing among themselves on a definition of the digital humanities, why they do it, and what it takes to be considered a member of the hearty DH band. DHers spend an awful lot of time arguing, debating what constitutes DH and what it means to practice DH. The University of Maryland's Max Kirschenbaum is as good a person to start with as any to define what DH is. He posed the following rhetorical question: what is DH and what is it doing in English departments, in the title of a 2010 essay that Matt Gold reprinted to kick off his debates collection, a book that I'd recommend your DH working group read and discuss. It's full of a lot of interesting things and discussions and arguments. In the essay, Kirschenbaum looks back in time for an answer to the two questions posed in his title, back to the origins of the humanities computing and literary and linguistic computing movements. Those initiatives, some of them now more than a quarter century old, yielded important results, notably the Text Encoding Initiative, TEI, established in 1989, which set the XML, which stands for the Extensible Markup Language Standard, for marking up scholarly text for presentation on the web, as well as the original 2001 appearance of the Companion to Digital Humanities from Blackwell, a foundational text in DH, in which the field took on its current DH identity, thanks to a suggestion from John Unsworth of the University of Virginia of a name change from Humanities Computing to Digital Humanities that ultimately and decisively stuck. One reason the Kirschenbaum could pose the question about English departments in the second part of his title is that so many early DH projects were focused on building digital scholarly editions of canonical literary works and their key texts. The Whitman, Blake, and Rossetti archives and the Nines Initiative, which stands for Network Infrastructure for 19th Century Electronic Scholarship, all launched in the 1990s, are key examples. Each of these projects was connected directly or indirectly with English programs at their home campuses, and each took full advantage of TEI and the subsequent development of other software applications to build their digital scholarly editions and archives. The world of textual scholarship and analysis, at least the way such scholarly analysis was done inside of English departments, had been fundamentally transformed. While English has been the dominant academic discipline that helped drive the DH bandwagon, other academic disciplines, some squarely in the humanities, others outside of that disciplinary framework, have also played important roles in DH's development over the past decade. I would argue that when we define the humanities part of the digital humanities, we should think not only of the traditional humanities disciplines, for example, English, philosophy, languages, classics, etc., but also extend the definition by embracing the one used by the Mellon Foundation in its funding initiatives in the humanities. They say, quote, humanities is broadly understood to include the arts, history, languages, area studies, and zones of such fields as anthropology and geography that bridge the humanities and social sciences, unquote. If we start from this broader definition of the humanities, then I think Loyola University of Chicago literary scholar and DH'er Steve Jones, the other Steve Jones in this context, has as good a functional definition of DH as we need. DH, according to Jones, is, quote, an umbrella term for a diverse set of practices and concerns, all of which combine computing and digital media with humanities research and teaching, unquote. My only addition to Steve Jones's concise definition would be to emphasize the collaborative and interdisciplinary nature of the work process and the academic output of many DH projects. The traditional academic trope, the lone scholar laboring in a disciplinarily siloed archive, has been disrupted by DH praxis, with its emphasis on interdisciplinary inquiry and collaboration by a diversely skilled members of project teams that end up producing and conceiving most DH projects. I will have more to say about DH's collaborative and interdisciplinary nature in a few moments, but I would say you have a wonderful example of such a DH project right here on this campus. It happens to be my daughter's own history bus, which I just saw, much to my amazement and delight, and would recommend it to you highly as an example of that kind of a project. So, excuse that, that's the familiar thing that the Briers can't help themselves about. So what exactly can DH do that traditional academic approaches to scholarly work have not or cannot do? Let me start to answer that question by looking at the Stanford literary scholar Franco Moretti's Graphs, Maps, Trees, Abstract Models for Literary History. An especially thoughtful example of how DH scholarship can pose new research questions and develop new research methodologies to answer those questions. In his 2005 foundational DH text, Moretti argued that we can learn previously undiscovered things, what he calls emerging qualities, about the scope and nature of 18th and 19th century English prose fiction writing, his scholarly field, by employing what he calls distant reading techniques. Distant reading uses quantitative, spatial, and morphological data about the number, frequency, geographic spread, and genre and subgenre forms of the entire corpus of these British novels, which is about 200 to 300 books that he's looking at, as compared to the typical close reading most literary scholars do of a small number of canonical works in that corpus. And he does this to draw broader conclusions about those works and the larger historical, cultural, and geographical context out of which such novels emerge. If I had to use an instrument analogy to explain the concept of distant reading, I'd say its instrument of choice is a telescope rather than a microscope, which is what close reading is all about, metaphorically speaking. I won't try to summarize Moretti's larger conclusions in graphs, maps, and trees here. His analysis, which has strong historical materialist overtones, is too rich and nuanced to do that easily. But I will suggest that his provocative, slim book, it's all of 90 pages, is a must-read for all scholars, regardless of discipline, largely because Moretti challenges us to think interdisciplinarily and interdisciplinary and entirely new ways about analytical questions and methodological approaches that we rarely consider in the academy, given our abiding commitment to siloed disciplinary boundaries and our unyielding reliance on traditional research methodologies. Moretti's distant reading helps us understand that digital tools can create their own forms of inquiry and can yield new research questions that we never asked, let alone attempted to answer. Beyond making us rethink the very nature and forms of academic scholarship, as Moretti has done, DH has also managed to raise important questions about traditional forms of academic publication and the double-blind peer review process on which these publications are usually determined. Few can argue that the ways we have managed to publish most academic scholarship over the past century, in print periodicals and journals, and academic monographs published in small print runs, largely by university presses, can be sustained at anything close to previous levels. The economics of academic publishing, as well as evaporating university and public library budgets for new book and journal purchases, make it less and less likely that traditional print venues for scholarship can keep up with the expanding volume of academic output that needs to be printed. Nor can it meet the professional needs of the current and future generations of scholars who must publish their work to secure jobs, get promoted, and ultimately secure tenure, assuming that now venerable in academic protection system manages to survive the rapid changes that are sweeping universities worldwide. DHers have participated broadly in rethinking both the form and the process of traditional academic production, pushing forward a number of open access, open source publications that make academic publishing accessible more quickly in a variety of new digital formats, including digital journals, electronic books and blogs, aimed at both academic and public audiences. I would name Kairos, the Journal of Rhetoric, Technology, and Pedagogy, Digital Humanities Now, the Journal of Digital Humanities, and CUNY's own Journal of Interactive Technology and Pedagogy as but four examples of such new online open access journal publications. I'll have more to say about that in a minute. As with online publication of scholarship, digital humanists have also helped create new forms of academic peer review that take advantage of digital tools to make the academic assessment process faster, more collaborative, and more transparent. Let me offer but one example. Kathleen Fitzpatrick's important book, Planned Obsolescence, Publishing Technology and the Future of the Academy, published in 2011, in which she makes a provocative argument that the Academy's very future depends on our willingness to embrace new digital and collectively generated forms of peer review and academic publication. Fitzpatrick argues persuasively that only if the university can accomplish a dramatic move away from what she calls, quote, the pro- production and dissemination of individual academic products to imagining a system focused more broadly on facilitating the processes of scholarly work, unquote, will we be able to rescue academic peer review and academic publishing from itself? Her book's publisher, NYU Press, put its money behind Fitzpatrick's words. Dozens of peer reviewers, myself included, read and commented on draft chapters collectively online using a special piece of horizontal blogging software called Comment Press, developed by the Institute for the Future of the Book, prior to planned obsolescence's simultaneous publication as a print and ebook. It should be noted that NYU Press also sent the book out for traditional external reviews as well. While these traditional outside reviews were useful, Fitzpatrick and NYU Press both have credited the collaborative open online peer review process with demonstrably strengthening the final product. So what you can see here is the text is broken up into obviously chapters and sections, and each paragraph can be commented on separately by any outside reviewer, which is what happened here. And so basically anybody can come in. This was a more select group of reviewers who were invited in to comment, but she sort of generated 50 or 60 sets of comments at the paragraph level on her manuscript before she finalized it. And it was a very powerful and effective way for her to get that kind of feedback. And she was then able to engage with commenters and critics at the time as the book was being finalized and put together, rather than waiting a year or two for an academic review and then having the opportunity or not to respond to reviewers. Perhaps more important than the way Fitzpatrick's book was reviewed and published was her thoughtful and insightful analysis in its pages of what is wrong with the current state of academic publishing, peer reviewing, and academic assessment. Fitzpatrick argues that the supposed cloak of anonymity, intolerable delays in the review, revision, and publication processes, the potential for favoritism or self-serving decisions on the part of anonymous peer reviewers and journal and press editors, and most tellingly, the entirely opaque quality of the peer review process, all have contributed to an increasingly dysfunctional peer review system for print journals and monographs that restricts rather than encourages new scholarly approaches and narrows the channels for academic publication rather than expands them. Like Moretti, Fitzpatrick writes as a member of the DH community, and also like Moretti, she has provided a thoughtful, insightful, and transformative analysis that reimagines academic practices that we previously have thought of as immutable. This is a second DH book that I recommend that all faculty members and graduate students, as well as college administrators, read and, more importantly, talk about to help spur much-needed conversations about how and why we need to change our academic assessment practices as a new generation of scholars, many of them immersed in and engaged by the digital humanities, move through the tenure and promotion processes. Digital humanities and the digital affordances upon which it is based also offers possibilities for pursuing not only new approaches to scholarly inquiry and to academic publishing and evaluation, but also a new set of career options for graduate students and younger faculty members. In pushing the academy to rethink the very institutional and professional structures that have evolved and come to define the university over the past century of academic life, DH has also helped generate and valorize a whole new set of job possibilities within the academy. What Bethany Nowitzki of the University of Virginia's Scholarly Communications Institute in 2010 dubbed ALT-AC, ALT-AC, or, quote, unconventional or alternative careers for people with academic training, unquote. ALT-AC has become something of a movement inside the academy and inside of DH in the past few years with its own well-articulated ideology and online publication. This is near, which also uses Media Commons, by the way, the same software that Kathleen Tony Fitzpatrick and NYU Press use. So it's a very much a blogging software that encourages interaction and response. In explaining her motivation for coming, for coining the original ALDAC phrase to launch the movement, Novitsky said she saw this as, quote, a pointed pushback against the predominant phrase non-academic careers. Non-academic was the label for anything off the straight and narrow path of tenure, unquote. ALDACers are often found in university research centers and university libraries, working in a range of full-time non-teaching positions within higher education, where they help develop and implement a range of digital technologies in academic teaching and in academic research. ALDACers can also be found outside of the university in museums, government agencies, historical societies, and journalism. In a very real sense, ALDAC positions help broaden the possibilities of gainful and fulfilling employment for PhDs beyond the traditional framework of tenure-track academic jobs. To underscore these alternative possibilities and how they can play out, I'm going to engage in some personal and professional metacognition, as we say in the ed viz, and spend a few moments sketching my own trajectory as a historian who now thinks of himself, at least some of the time, as a digital humanist, or more accurately, a premature digital humanist, a somewhat forced bit of irony I used in my article in Matt Gold's collection. I'll explain what a premature digital humanist is for any of you who don't know the historical reference. To help understand how I found my way into DH at this late stage in my academic life, I do this not because my now nearly four decades long career in the academy is so emblematic, it isn't at all, but rather as a way of underscoring another basic point that I want to make about DH. There are many intellectual, pedagogical, and professional roads that lead into and out of this nascent scholarly field. I was trained as a labor historian at UCLA in the early 1970s. It's interesting for me now to realize that my first scholarly article was published when I was still a graduate student way back in 1977 in the Journal of Interdisciplinary History, actually used digital technology in the form of old-fashioned computer punch cards and a very large mainframe IBM 360 computer at the UCLA Computing Center to analyze strike activity by coal miners in the United States in the late 19th century based on a data set developed and published in that era by the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics. The IBM 360's ability to quickly crunch a set of complicated statistics quickly then meant I had to wait overnight to pick up my computer printouts. Using the then brand new program Statistical Package for the Social Sciences, the now venerable SPSS, allowed me and my co-author John Amston to ask new questions about workers' behaviors and beliefs that used correlation and regression analysis to develop new insights and uncover historical trends that would have been quite difficult to see using conventional historical methods, very akin to the kind of thing that Moretti was talking about. By the time the coal strike article appeared in print, I had already made the decision to leave graduate school and move to New York to accept a job in public television, researching and making historical films, where, by the way, I met Leon Fink and Sue Levine, UIC's own faculty members. I reasoned at that point in my then quite young academic career that while it was still possible for me to secure a traditional academic job as a history professor, I was in fact offered such a position in Notre Dame, I decided I wanted to do public history in non-academic ways. Little did I realize at that time that I was founding the family business, as my daughter likes to describe it. And that filmmaking gave me a better chance to present the past to broader public audiences than would a traditional academic position. I guess this makes me a premature alt-acker as well. Parenthetically, I would note that the now three decades old public history movement was an effort by then largely young scholars, similar to what DHers are doing today, to reimagine what it meant to do history for a wider public audience, moving history beyond the narrow confines of traditional scholarship to encompass non-print formats and presentational styles that would broaden history's impact on the general public. Besides learning how to make history films in New York in the late 1970s, I also had the great good fortune to meet Herbert Guttman, the distinguished labor and social historian who did so much to reshape our thinking about how U.S. history should be written, taught, and presented to the public. As you've heard, Herb and I founded the American Social History Project at the City University in 1981. I'll just show the rather large and complicated ASHP website if you're interested in finding out, to design and create books, films, videos, and after 1992, a variety of digital media to put American working people's experience at the center of the U.S. historical narrative. Among the project's most important accomplishments was the publication of its Who Built America multimedia history curriculum that included a 2-volume college textbook and 10 history documentaries on video, still a cutting-edge educational technology in the 1980s and 90s when we conceived and produced them. The WBA multimedia curriculum also included the nation's first fully digital publication on U.S. history, the award-winning CD-ROM, Who Built America, from the centennial celebration of 1876 to the Great War of 1914. Conceived and developed by the late Roy Rosenzweig, Josh Brown, and me, and published commercially by the Voyager Company in 1993. The first WBA CD-ROM was followed 8 years later by a second CD-ROM, covering the years from 1914 to 1946. To underscore my earlier point that there are multiple pathways leading to the emergence of DH, we were developing these pioneering digital interventions in history at ASHP at the exact same time and very much in parallel with the efforts of John Unsworth, Jerome McGann, and their University of Virginia colleagues who were pioneering the digital textual analysis tools that I talked about earlier that proved so essential to the launch of DH a decade later. And while Roy, Josh, and I hadn't self-identified at this point as DHers the way Unsworth and his colleagues did, what we did from that point forward, professionally and academically, was situate ourselves inside a broader digital public history movement, which had distinct resonances with more traditional DH work being done inside university English departments. Roy Rosenzweig, for example, went on in 1994 to found the Center for History and New Media at George Mason University, which remains 20 years later one of the most important DH labs and centers in the country, which he headed until his untimely death in 2007. In addition to CHNM's continued collaborative work with ASHP, which included the development of the September 11 Digital Archive, which I'll say more about in a minute, CHNM has also developed 2 path-breaking software programs, Zotero and Omeka, which you can find out about on their website, both of which have become standard applications used in numerous DH projects. I recommend both of them highly to you. To turn back to ASHP for a moment and to frame it within the emergent DH movement, one of the hallmarks of the WBA multimedia curriculum that Roy, Josh, and I helped create, and all of ASHP's digital history work in general that followed, has been the project's quarter-century-long commitment to using digital technologies to enhance the quality of teaching and learning of history at the high school and undergraduate levels. The 2 Who Built America CD-ROMs and other projects that ASHP developed after 1995, including the History Matters website, History Matters, the U.S. Survey course on the web, which we did in collaboration with CHNM, that makes a range of primary and secondary historical materials available to teachers and students, are built on the belief that digital technologies can and should be used to improve the teaching and learning of history. This commitment to digital pedagogy uses a wide array of textual, visual, sound, and moving image source materials that were previously inaccessible to those who might best benefit from such access in order to make history more immediate and multidimensional to students. We employed these multimedia resources to drive, quote, inquiry-based learning using primary sources, unquote, to employ Randy Bass's concise formulation. Working closely and collaboratively with teachers across the country in a series of grant-supported projects, ASHP helped pioneer a series of active learning strategies to improve history teaching, emphasizing, for example, the use of primary source documents and visual source materials to encourage students' deep immersion in historical thinking and history making. I consider ASHP's pedagogical work, which began in 1986, as much a pioneering DH effort as other academic research projects like the Whitman and Rossetti archives, which were being developed at the same time.